This conference will now be recorded.
Hello. Shall we start the class?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Today I'm going to discuss about osteosarcoma. I'm Ganesh, new assistant professor at the Department of Orthopedics. Okay, what is osteosarcoma? Actually, osteo means it's a bone, and the sarcoma means it is a malignant transformation of the osteoid cells. So, which occurs in bone. That's why it's called as name as osteosarcoma. Osteogenic sarcoma and osteosarcoma both are same only. Don't think it will be different. It's another mnemonic. That's it. It's then defined as a primary malignant tumor, which occurs in the neoplastic cells produced in osteoid matrix. The osteoid matrix will convert into the neoplastic cells and become malignancy. That's why it leads to an malignant growth will be there. And it is the second most common primary malignancy. And first thing is, people will know, multiple myeloma. This second most common, it is a bone malignancy. Not in all the malignancies, it is the second most common in primary malignancy of bone only. For multiple myeloma, it occurs in blood also. That's why it leads in first most common, it is multiple myeloma, and second most common, it is osteosarcoma. And of all the malignancies, osteosarcoma approximately 20% of all the primary malignancies of bone. Coming to demographics, 2 to 3 per million year. Yearly, it will in the United States, it will be more common than India. So in United States, it will be around 600 to 800 cases annually. That means yearly, they are having around 600 to 800 cases of osteosarcoma cases. And in adolescents, the osteosarcoma will be more common. Adolescent age means around 12 to 26, 27 years, up to 24 years, it is the most common. In second osteosarcomas, I will discuss it later. In that second osteosarcomas, it will be more common in older individuals, whereas in primary osteosarcoma, it will be common in adolescent years. And coming to the ratio, males are more prone for osteosarcomas. That's why the ratio will be 3:2. Males are 3 and females are 2. Etiology is mainly purely based on more commonly due to chromosomal abnormalities only, and some of genes also. The genes which occurs, which are prone to osteosarcoma is RB gene, that is retinoblastoma gene, and P53 gene. These two genes are most common for prone for osteosarcoma, and some of the chromosomes also. Not only these chromosomes, actually so many chromosomes are there, but these 3Q, 13Q, 17P and 18Q, these four are most commonly involved and prone for osteosarcomas. Second is osteosarcoma. It is commonly seen in patients with Paget's disease and post radiation treatment, that more than 25 gray. This is a GWA, that is gray is nothing but it's an unit for radiation. For radiation, they will give some around 5 to 10 like that. If the radiation will be more, then they are more common for more prone for osteosarcomas. And some patients with fibrous dysplasia and bone infect also, these patients are more prone for secondary osteosarcoma. Site of origin, everyone knows, in bone there will be epiphysis, metaphysis and diaphysis, out of which metaphysis will more prone, around 89% the osteosarcomas will occur in metaphyseal area, and 10% only will occur in diaphysis, and 1% in epiphysis. So it will occur in anywhere, metaphyseal, epiphyseal or diaphysis, but in epiphysis it is too rare, and metaphysis it is more common. That is around 90% will occur in the metaphysis, and in metaphysis also, the larger metaphysis, it will be more prone to osteosarcoma. That is a distal femur, proximal tibia and proximal humerus, wherever the blood flow will be more, and these metaphyseal area, they're having pinlobe hole, pinlobe blood circulation will be there. That's why it will be more common in metaphyseal area. Out of which 52% occur in femur only, and 20% in tibia, and 9% in humerus, and rest 19% will occur in pelvis. It will occur in any bone, but more prone for the femur, tibia, and humerus will be more prone for osteosarcomas. 19% will occur in pelvis, jawbone, cranial vault, that is cranial bones, and in spine also it will occur. Coming to classification, it divides into primary and secondary osteosarcomas. In primary osteosarcoma, again it will be into conventional high grade osteosarcoma, low grade intramedullary osteosarcoma, periosteal osteosarcoma, periosteal osteosarcoma, and telangiectatic osteosarcoma. This is somewhat rare. Okay, out of this, this is somewhat rare. You can just remember it as high grade sarcoma and low grade sarcoma, periosteal and periosteal osteosarcoma in primary. In primary osteosarcoma, coming to high grade osteosarcoma, this is begin in intramedullary, that is in the bone it will occur, and it break the cortex and leads into the soft tissue. So in primary high grade osteosarcomas, there will be the soft tissue swelling also, because it break the cortex. It will normally first it occur in intramedullary, that is in the bone only. After that it will leads to, it will break the cortex and it will come to the muscle. So there will be the soft tissue mass will be there. See in this x-ray, it shows distal femur shows osteosarcoma. It affects the outer cortex and it's coming to the muscle. So there will be the bulge in the muscle. This is the proximal humerus, which show the how the humerus will affected. In high grade osteosarcoma, we are in a high grade osteosarcoma only. In high grade osteosarcoma, the histopathology shows spindle cell component and hypercellularity and mitotic figures and marked nuclear pleomorphism will be there. In high grade osteosarcomas, spindle cell component will be there. The spindle cell components will be there, and hypercellular, all these violet colors will be there. You know, that will be the hypercellularity. Okay, this will be seen in high grade osteosarcomas. And come to low grade osteosarcomas, it is a somewhat rare type, and it is like it looks like a benign, but is an malignant only. For this low grade, there will be the differential diagnostic osteoblastoma or fibrous dysplasia. In fibrous dysplasia, the low grade osteosarcoma, it looks like same only, but there will be some features. And histologically, when compared with the high grade, here atypical spindle cell will be there and irregular osseous trabeculae will be present. See in this low grade, there will be not much of a high grade reaction. The bone will be looks will be normal, but there will be the reaction will be there, cortical reactions will be there, but it won't pierce the cortex and it won't go to the muscle. There will be muscle mass, but it won't break the cortex. In high grade, there will be the breakage of cortex will be there. In low grade, it does not occur. And come to periosteal osteosarcoma, it is an intermediate grade malignancy that arises on the outer aspect of the cortex of bone. Periosteal osteosarcoma, where it will occur means on the outer layer it is cortex, after that the periosteum will be there. In periosteum, there will be the two layers. One is outer is fibrous layer, and inner layer is cellular or fibrocellular layer will be there. So the periosteal osteosarcoma will arise from that inner cellular layer. That's why it will arises on the outer aspect of the cortex of bone under the periosteum, that is inner layer of the periosteum. This sarcoma will occur in slightly older age group, not in not like high grade and low grade. Those will occur around in adolescent group, that is 12 to 26 group. This periosteal osteosarcoma will occur in older age group, slightly older group, not older, slightly older age means that will be around in 40 years, 30 to 40 years. Okay, and the most common same as high grade and low grade, that is that metaphyseal area of the femur and tibia. In this histological examination, there will be the osteoid producing cells, spindle cells radiating between the between lobules of cartilage. See here, the spindle cell will be there, and the lobules will be there, and around that there will be the osteoid producing cells will be there around the spindle radiating cells. In X-ray showing how the primary osteosarcoma, that means periosteal osteosarcoma will be present. See this X-ray and see this, because still periosteum will be intact. It will occur between the cortex and periosteal inner layer. That's why still the periosteum will be intact in this periosteal osteosarcoma. And one more thing, that is periosteal osteosarcoma. Just think, periosteal, it will occur between the outer cortex and inner layer of the periosteum. Whereas periosteal osteosarcoma, it is a low grade malignancy on the surface of the bone and invades medullary cavity at the leg stage. It will occur the same as like periosteal, but it will malignancy means some stages is the stage 1, stage 2, in stage 4, that is the late stage, it will invades the medullary cavity into the bone. It will leads into the bone. For this differential diagnosis, myositis ossificans and osteochondroma, we have to rule out osteochondroma and myositis ossificans to diagnose the periosteal osteosarcoma. Coming to the secondary osteosarcoma, most commonly it occurs in incidence in Paget's disease. It's around 1%, and it will occur in 6th to 8th decades. That is older age group only it will occur secondary osteosarcomas. And most commonly pelvis is the most common location for secondary osteosarcoma. Not like primary osteosarcoma, that is distal femur, proximal tibia and proximal humerus. But here the pelvis is the most common for the secondary osteosarcomas. And in radiation also, post-induced osteosarcomas in radiation also, it will be more common. The secondary osteosarcomas will be common. See, this X-ray shows X-ray of the humerus, which is fibrous, which is a Paget's disease of the humerus. See how the bone will thicken, and how the sclerotic means nothing but whitish, the change in the bone, that is the cortex become whitish, too whitish, and there will be the fracture due to the osteosarcoma. See this same X-ray show the specimen, how this osteosarcoma, secondary osteosarcoma will occur. Not there will be this some underlying cause, that's why the secondary osteosarcoma will arise, like Paget's disease, some secondary, some radiation exposure to radiation. In those people only it will be the more common. And secondary osteosarcomas locations are like skull bones, spine, clavicle, ribs, scapula and pelvis. All these are the flat bones of the flat bones in the body. Skull is also flat bone, clavicle, ribs are the flat bones, scapula flat bone, pelvis, all these are occurs in flat bone, not in major limbs like lower limb, upper limb. These sarcomas will convert at least if any patient took around 10 to 15 years of radiation, he leads to an secondary osteosarcomas. Okay, mostly these secondary osteosarcomas associated with fibrous dysplasia, osteogenesis imperfecta, bone infect, chronic osteomyelitis and dedifferentiated chondrosarcoma. All in these patients, it will mostly leads to a secondary osteosarcomas. Pathophysiology in secondary osteosarcoma, the tumor will grow in two directions, that is inwards and outwards. That is towards the medullary cavity it will grow, and towards the subperiosteal it will be grow. See, if it grows towards the under the periosteum, see, under the periosteum it will lead to another new bone formation, but there will be no breakage, but there will be the new bone formation under the periosteum. That's why in X-ray it shows like some reaction will be there around the cortex. Normally this line will be the normal cortex, but there will be a reaction on the cortex, but it is under the periosteum. In X-ray it's called as Quadmans triangle and sundry burst appearance will occur in osteosarcoma. You have to remember that this is the Quadmans triangle, nothing but there will be the new bone formation under the periosteum over the cortex, but there is no breach in the cortex. See this, the osteosarcoma, it will grow into the medullary cavity and under the periosteum. Okay, it will invade the cortex, but it does not invade the periosteum. Okay, remember that. Coming to clinical features, pain is the first symptom, especially at night time, and later the patient will complaining of slight limp. Limp is slightly limp. He will limp. And another finding, it is swelling. There is a deep, firm, fixed mass, because it is fixed to the bone. That's why there is no movement in that mass. It is fixed mass, and we have to palpate that mass, because whether any pulsations and any bruit is there or not, because we have to, any swelling we have to palpate whether there is pulsations or not, because the I said no, there is a third one, rare osteosarcoma, telangiectic osteosarcoma. In this there will be the pulsations and bruit, because it is a vascular tumor. Okay, there will be the vascularity also in vascularity in those tumors. That's why we have to, all the tumors we have to see any pulsations is there, any bruit is there or not. Bruit means that you have to identify with your stethoscope, then only you can know. And clinical features, first is pain and swelling. Another thing, there is limitation of the joint movements. Limitation of the joint movement. There will be joint movement, the range of movements will be decreased. And it leads to a pathological fracture also. Osteosarcoma, it leads to a pathological fracture. Some of the clinical photos were showing the, say this distal femur, showing how the leg is swollen, and there will be the visible veins will be shown. The skin is shows shiny also. This is the proximal humerus, shows the osteosarcoma, same as distal femur. All these in these patients, the visible veins will be there, and the skin will be shiny and stretched. Another clinical, the constitutional symptoms will be there. Those are weight loss, fever, cough, loss of appetite. All these are present in osteosarcoma, and generalized weakness will be there, and signs of anemia. And this is an osteosarcoma. There is a metastasis to the metastasis means it will leads to an it leads and it will affect the other organs also. Most commonly it is involve the pulmonary, it will involve the lungs. Osteosarcoma, the malignancy will leads to an pulmonary metastasis. Diagnosis, it is based on hematological, that is blood tests, and plain radiography, CT, MRI, bone scan, PET scan, and arteriography and biopsy. Coming to hematological, out of which hemoglobin will be decreased in osteosarcoma patients, and total leukocyte count will be increased, and ESR will be raised. Any infection, any tumors, the total count and ESR will be raised, and serum calcium also increased. Normal serum calcium level is around 8.6 to 10.4. It will, in osteosarcomas, the serum calcium will be increased, and serum alkaline phosphatase, this is also increased. It will be more than 400 international units per liter. Normally the serum alkaline phosphatase level is around 20 to 140, but in osteosarcomas it will be more, that is around more than 400 it will be there. Radiography, always in osteosarcomas, plain radiography remains the mainstay, not don't say it is an MRI or CT finding. It is a plain radiography which shows everything. It shows location, where it will be there, whether and shape, globular or pear shape, it will be tell, and margins and the matrix mineralization, whether there is any cortical involvement or not, any periosteal reaction and any fracture, all these will show in plain radiograph only. Don't think MRI, CT will needs for osteosarcoma. Plain radiography is enough. We can say whether it is osteosarcoma or not. Okay. In radiography, as I said, there will be the two things. One is Codman's triangle And one more thing is sunray burst appearance. Quadmans triangle, it is nothing but periosteum will be stripped for short distance and deposition of new bone. Deposition of new bone under the periosteum, it's like arranged around the parallel to the shaft. There will be the growth, there will be the bone growth under the periosteum, and the periosteal stripping will be there. That's why it looks like a triangle shape. It will be the Quadmans triangle. And sometimes it leads to a pathological fractures. Then only patient will know some problem will be there. Till then, they are looking normal only. Once the pathological fractures occurs, then only incidental finding also in some patients. But mainly the patients will damn sure they will be come with pain and swelling will be there surely. If they in neglected patients, it leads to a fracture. And one more finding is sunray appearance. See how the bone scattered. Bone the scattered with the muscle, and it will occur in the periosteum only. Don't think it will come out from the periosteum. It will beneath the periosteum and triangles to the cortex. So in osteosarcoma, there will be in X-ray finding, there will be the two findings. One thing is Quadmans triangle, another one is sunray appearance will be there. After that only we have to plan for CT scan. CT scan, it is just for any metastasis other than that bone. That is any we have to do for CT lens to detect any pulmonary metastasis there or not. Because before going to treatment, we have to know whether any metastasis is there or not, and how much the osteosarcoma extended in the bone. Okay. And over the plain CT, always contrast CT is the preferred one for osteosarcoma patients. MRI, magnetic resonance imaging. This is mainly for any evolution or any invasion of the osteosarcoma in the muscle and neurovascular structures. You have to do by MRI only. If any muscle invasion or any neurovascular structures, you have to go for MRI. For CT, it doesn't show whether it is involved in muscle or neurovascular. It shows how much the bone will be affected. It shows that much thing only. And whether any metastasis is there or not in lungs, it will show. But it does not show whether there is involvement in the muscle or not. If not only osteosarcoma, for any patients, if something problem in the muscle or vascularity region, you have to go for MRI. CT, it just only shows the how much the bone will be affected. For any fractures, you have to go for CT, not MRI. For MRI, it is mainly for muscle and neurovascular structures. Okay. After that, we can go for bone scan. In bone scan, they use some radioisotope, that is technetium 99. They will be used the radio. It is a radioisotope. So if they induce that radioisotope technetium 99, wherever the alkaline phosphatase will be more, it will be the more brightened in color. It will be up, there will be extended pattern optic. See this right side proximal tibia, how it will be there. In bone scan, it looks like this. Okay, don't think these are all osteosarcomas, this black and because in metaphysis, epiphyseal, that is at physis also, it will be uptake will be more. Don't think that is osteosarcoma. This one is the osteosarcoma proximal leg. Okay, and this is the front side and this is the back side of the body, how the osteosarcoma will be there. But in bone scan, it does not detect the skip metastasis. That means if any metastasis occur in other bone, any lungs, it does not show. That's why we can go for after that bone scan, there will be the PET scan will be there. Any sarcomas, any neoplasms, any malignant conditions, we have to do PET scan. Because in PET scan only, we will know whether any metastasis other than that bone, wherever in body, it will shows. That's why the PET scan is the most important in all the neoplastic patients. Any neoplasms or any malignant conditions, we have to do for PET scan. That is positron emission imaging. Okay, this is the PET scan. See, one of the patient pre chemo means that is a chemotherapy means that is some of the drugs which are for any neoplastic patients, for any malignancy patients will give before giving chemo in proximal tibia, how it's showing osteosarcoma, and post chemo there will be the decrease of the disease, decrease of the that malignant cells. PET scan is the important one, but mainstay whatever you have to tell, whatever best scan for osteosarcoma, that is X-ray only. Don't take MRI or CT. Arteriography we have to know, because for that swelling there will be the some arterial supply will be there, so we have to do for arteriography also, because after doing arteriography then only we'll know where you want to do for where you want to go for embolization. Because once if you do for any arterial embolization, so that the blood supply to the swelling will be decreased, so that the growth will be decreased. That's where the important arteriography. Transcatheter, that is, and it's not open surgery, arterial embolization in the vessels only they will do, because you know, they'll go for and they will do, and they'll put some block arterial embolization, that is blocking of the arteries, and there will be the blood supply will be cut off to that swelling, so that the growth of the swelling will be decreased. And biopsy, don't think biopsy is the final diagnostic procedure. It is don't think it is a shortcut for diagnosis. Always first you have to go for X-ray, and then you have a plan for other whether you want to CT MRI or not, then only you can do for biopsy. Don't think biopsy is the shortcut to diagnosis. Okay, biopsy, there will be the some biopsies are there. FNAC, that is fine needle aspiration cytology. Fine needle aspiration cytology, this will be done for only some only for any muscle, any soft tissue involvement only we have to go for fine needle, because the needle will be so sharp, so we will go for fine needle in any muscle involvement. If in case of bone involvement, we have to go for Truckett needle biopsy or Jamshedi core needle biopsy. These two needles will be available for any involvement of the bone. Okay, biopsy we can go for excisional or incisional. Excision means we have to open that site and we have to take the biopsy. Incisional means small, they will pass this needle, Jamshedi core needle, they will pass directly that needle into the cortex and they will took the biopsy. Histology, in this histology, as I said, there will be the anaplastic tumor cells, there will be the more number of anaplastic tumor cells, and the calcification of the osteoids will be present, and that trabeculae that involved in the osteo, the bone will be more. All these occurs in high grade osteosarcomas. Treatment, it's not only orthopedician, there will be the radiologist, pathologist, oncology, psychiatry, and prosthetic. Treatment for low grade osteosarcomas, there will be the wide surgical resection of the treatment of choice. In low grade, if there is a distal femur involvement, will that is a wide surgical resection means they will cut the femur along with the sum of healthy femur also we have to cut it. That's why it's called as wide surgical resection is the treatment of choice. In these patients, mostly there will be without adjuvant chemotherapy, the patients will recover in low grade. But in high grade osteosarcomas, patients need neoadjuvant chemotherapy. Neoadjuvant chemotherapy means before planning for surgery, we'll give some cycles of chemotherapy because if you give chemotherapy before the surgery, the tumor the tumor staging will be decreased. Because if it is stage 2, stage 3, if it is stage 3 or stage 4, but after giving the chemotherapy, it will come to stage 2, then you can plan for surgery. It will be somewhat useful. So in these patients, first they need neoadjuvant chemotherapy. That means before surgery, they will give chemotherapy and then they plan for wide surgical resection or radical amputation. Radical amputation means if the lower femur will be involved, distal femur will be involved means they'll remove the total up to hip joint, they will remove that. and then adjuvant chemotherapy. The main goal of chemotherapy is to treat the non-detectable micrometastasis. Okay. If there is any non-detectable micrometastasis will be there, if you give chemotherapy, it will reduce somewhat, then we can plan for surgeries. In osteosarcomas, what and all drugs they will use? That is doxorubicin, cisplatin, methotrexate, and ifosfamide. These four drugs they will use in osteosarcoma for chemotherapy. These are the chemotherapy agents for using in osteosarcoma. That is doxorubicin, cisplatin, methotrexate, and ifosfamide. Surgery, we have to while planning for surgery, we have to see whether we can save the limb or not. If you can save the limb, we have to go for limb salvage. Limb salvage means we have to try to save the limb. That is the limb salvage procedures or amputation. Whether if you're deciding whether limb salvage or amputation, that is mainly based on whether the patient's how the patient financial status and what the patient what is a worker or is a sportsman. We have to see that. And where is the tumor site, how much it is extended, we have to see. Then only we have to plan for limb salvage or amputation. If you want to do for limb salvage procedure, that is, we have to, the patient don't want amputation. The patients want surgery, they want their limb. Means then you can go for limb salvage procedures. In these limb salvage procedures, they will use endoprocesses. What is endoprocesses? Normally, processes means for above knee amputation, for below knee amputation, after removing the diseased part of leg, they will put some processes. Okay, in endoprocesses means they will keep some implant in place of diseased bone. See, the distal femur will affected. So we cut that diseased distal femur and we'll place this implant. That is endoprocesses. Endoprocess, we have to customize it, because before surgery they will took the how much they want stem, everything they will calculate and they will decide and they will keep this implant in place of the femur. See x-ray how it shows, there will be the no bone, there will be the no distal femur bone. In that place they will keep this process. That's why it's called an endoprocesis. Inside the limb they will place it. Other surgeries, that is any autografts, any allografts, autografts, that means autographs, allografts means they will use any bone in place. After cutting that diseased bone, they will keep some healthy bone in place of that in place of diseased bone. Arthrodesis, they will plan for arthrodesis, that is fusion of the limbs, they can plan it also. And last final surgery, that is rotationoplasty. It's not done in India, but in foreign countries they are doing rotationoplasty. What is it, rotationoplasty? See, if the distal femur if affected, they will cut, that is wide resection, that they will cut up to the proximal femur and proximal tibia up to this. They will remove this part and the remaining part will connect it to the proximal femur. This is the rotationoplasty. How much the limb affected, they will take the wide resection of that limb and the remaining leg and foot will attach it to the remaining part of the thigh bone. This is the rotationoplasty. See, in this type, they will if the proximal femur is affected, they will transect up to here and the remaining part, that is distal femur and the knee joint, will directly attach it to the remaining part of the pelvis. All these are rotationoplasty. Just they will how much the limb is affected in, see, in this femur, if the femur is affected completely, they will remove the whole femur, that is radical dissection they will do, and the remaining part, that is tibia and femur, directly it will attach to the hip joint. That is the rotationoplasty. He is Terry Fox. is the main person for an osteosarcoma because he born in Canada and he diagnosed with osteosarcoma, and they amputated the leg up to above knee. They amputated it in 1977. That is when he was in 18 years old. They amputated the leg. After that, he should not lose his hope, and he ran for marathon up to 5373 kilometers. After that, he stopped because due to of lung metastasis, so he is unable to walk, and he died in 1981. He's the Terry Fox, and they're maintaining one foundation that is on the name of, on the behalf of Terry Fox. Around they are collecting $400 million for cancer research. It will be there. His name is Terry Fox. Remember this person always. Thank you guys. Thank you so much. That's why in first slide I show this. Name is the Terry Fox. Okay, thank you guys. Any questions? Anybody, is there any questions? Am I audible? Any questions?
No, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, guys.